Hi, and welcome to a 6-5 live broadcast here on LinkedIn. Daniel, this is the first one that we've done on here, and we were waiting for some early breaking news that we could talk about and provide some analysis. And well, AMD and Xilinx provided it.
Yeah, absolutely. I woke up to a message from you really early this morning because I get up really early as it is. And it's like, hey, wake up. I've already been up all night writing an article on Forbes to let everybody know that this deal got done. I mean, it feels like just about a week ago, I was publishing a speculative piece on MarketWatch talking about why this will be a good deal, but also why it might not be as good a deal as the ARM NVIDIA deal. But here we are. Now it's done. And on top of that, Pat, the company dropped its earnings this morning and the numbers for AMD were terrific. So a couple of things to talk about here on our first LinkedIn Live. But yeah, excited to be here.
Yeah, why don't we kick it off with earnings just to make it easy here. And I think it's obvious the company timed the two together to really point out from an AMD point of view that this wasn't coming out of weakness, that was coming out of strength, and that they had a lot of more organic growth to go. And while normally we don't give the numbers on this live, I think we should because this is fresh information. So AMD showed they beat on revenue and on EPS. They had a 56% year-on-year growth in revenue. Record PC CPU revenue, highest ever notebooks and revenue, record server revenue, over 2x. Now, you know, I would have expected, you know, I always want more, right? I know it's a lower number and AMD has that. I want a 3x server number, but, you know, maybe I'm asking for too much here. On the call, CEO Lisa Su said she does believe that the company gained CPU client share for the 12th straight quarter, and they have 105 AMD-based notebooks, and they've doubled their commercial notebooks, which commercial is higher margin, and I think that's a good thing.
Yeah, it was an impressive quarter, Pat. I mean, you point to the year-over-year revenue. You also had 45% up quarter over quarter. So it's not just growing over, a flat year. The company really is accelerating. The gross profit, 58% growth, that's huge numbers too. A couple other things that did draw my attention is the income at 141% year-over-year growth and the earnings per share, which was something I am historically critical of because the timed earnings value of the stock, you know, it was producing 11 cents of earnings a quarter. The stock is trading at $70, $80. It just seemed... the valuation seemed crazy, whereas Intel wasn't even getting a fraction of that valuation, but 191% growth, Pat, for earnings per share. So you have to give credit where credit's due. Lisa Su and team are performing well, executing well, and growing in all the categories. I mean, they're growing in notebooks and they're also growing in server. And that's an area that I've also said, I think they're going to struggle at times. And in this case, she's definitely proving that the company can compete and can impact. And that takes us very nicely into this move because really I heard her come straight into the call today and say, our ambition is to really lead in high performance. And high performance is kind of like Xilinx's middle name, right? Xilinx high performance chips. So that acquisition, which you wrote a great piece on Forbes, I think you should throw it in the comments after we're done here. You know, it basically, it's an acquisition that's going to close end of 2021 or within 2021, very similar timetable as the ARM NVIDIA deal. And it instantly provides additional credibility to the company. And what I liked about it probably the most, just jumping in, is that it kind of diversified. So there's some areas like communications and automotive where Xilinx is really strong, but their high performance portfolio gets bigger. And the two companies, which, by the way, you know, the Xilinx president has experience with AMD. So this is sort of a natural, there's some natural synergies here. But the big question I have on my mind is, one is, how big can it be? How big is this FPGA potential? And then, of course, AMD does not have a big acquisition track record. How quickly can it really get the intellectual property and the synergies going without that sort of tuned engine for acquisitions like some of the other makers?
Right. Yeah, that that's great commentary. So it's a big deal, right? I mean, in the rumors, it was talking about $30 billion. It's actually $35 billion. And I was listening to CNBC this morning. I know there was some commentary on, wow, that seems expensive. So I think, you know, Lisa and Victor, you know, have some explaining to do on that. Some things that have soaked in for me over the last week of thinking through this is first off, I like the short term makes more sense to me. You know, I talked to AMD CEO Lisa Su last night about the deal, and she talked about synergies. Even let's say at an account, let's say Xilinx is at a carrier and AMD is not in that business, and the ability to come together with a solution that doesn't necessarily have to be integrated on a single piece of silicon or some type of advanced packaging. The other thing that struck me, and I knew it, but I really didn't see it as part of the deal, is synergy in terms of the technologies that they use. So for instance, them and AMD and Xilinx both use, you know, bleeding edge of TSMC. They both do advanced packaging. AMD was one of the first companies, if not the first company, it was either Xilinx or AMD that used high bandwidth memory to connect multiple pieces of high performance silicon. And I would expect these things to go ahead in the future when you talk about 3D stacking that, you know, Intel has talked a ton about. But again, this is some new thinking, Daniel. In addition to your smart comments about new markets in the future. The other thing that came out in the conversation is Lisa Su is really excited about SmartNICs. Imagine that. Do. No, I know. Ever since, it's funny, even though this concept of SmartNIC is not new, NVIDIA sure made it popular out there, right? And I didn't even know that Xilinx did SmartNICs. And for what it's worth, I think Xilinx business will likely benefit from AMD's communications capability because I do think that AMD communicates a lot more to the market. And I think they can likely make that stick.
Yeah, it's interesting you say that. It feels like our friends at Marvell are feeling some pressure right now. The company that really sort of drove that SmartNIC category in a lot of ways, and now you got NVIDIA coming hard with kind of newly categorizing it. And now you've got a strengthened AMD and Xilinx coming together, which you only know is going to put more pressure. And as I always say, more competition, more innovation. But sometimes too much innovation and too much pressure can be tough on companies. So that'll be a really interesting thing to watch, Pat. A couple quick notes I'll say. One is you did make a great point about price, and I want to come back to that. You know, I think the revenue it adds is significant. I think that, you know, this is certainly brings a new competitive pressure to Intel because Xilinx is undoubtedly the biggest competitor in the FPGA space for Intel, which, you know, that will only make AMD shareholders and, you know, bulls more excited because AMD has had a strong run while Intel's had a good revenue run, but had more question around its business over the past few quarters. You know, let me just bring back to that price and point. This is the biggest issue I had with this deal. When I wrote my Market Watch piece, I basically said, I can't get to the number. That's my big problem. $35 billion. You just saw an ARM acquisition that has, you know, a litany of intellectual property that's going to diversify the portfolio and put NVIDIA into the CPU space in a big way and into billions of devices because of ARM's IP. Xilinx being in the FPGA space, if AMD had that ASIC capability in house right now, right? Because that's what made the move for Intel so successful with, you know, having FPGA and the ASIC capabilities in house, because I see so much of the trend moving that way. So much of the trend is you use FPGAs to build these high power, custom chips, programmability, and in certain applications, that's the perma state, but in a lot of applications, FPGAs are used to test chips that will be eventually delivered at scale as ASICs. And right now I'm wondering kind of what AMD's plan is to deliver that at scale, because to get the value back, $35 billion, I mean, heck, Pat, we still remember how much criticism IBM's been getting for Red Hat at $34 billion, and think of how big a business that business was there. So it's not the tech, Pat. I think the tech is right. I think it's a good merge, a good acquisition. I think Lisa's, you know, definitely has the right to be bullish, and I think both companies and shareholders should feel good about this acquisition. The price will continue to come back, though, as the combined revenues aren't going to be that significant. So the growth is going to have to come from the synergies it creates and how it scales beyond that $3 billion in revenue that Xilinx is going to deliver.
Yeah, related to price, and again, I'll let the investment bankers and the folks on Wall Street take care of that.
Yeah.
As a reminder, do not take any off this show for investment purposes. This is for entertainment and informational purposes only. But
good call.
With that said, I mean, I look at you know, the combined company, the non-GAAP numbers. You're looking at, you know, AMD going from 45% gross margin to 51%, operating income going from 16 to 21%, and free cash flow going from 8% to 15%. That's on day one, right? That's with zero synergies. And the company in their press release and their deck did talk about an additional $300 million in cost synergies. And I see that as an OPEX, human resources, finance, supply chain. And there was also some discussion about cost of goods sold, and where's the biggest cost of goods sold? It's at TSMC. So, and likely, you know, when you do a deal like this, you go in and you open the books, and I'm sure they looked at the per wafer pricing that Xilinx was paying TSMC, compared that to what AMD was pricing. And AMD does, they drive a lot more volume there. And I think, that's where they didn't say it, but that's where I think they're expecting to get that. And they gave themselves 18 months, right? So you take a year that it's going to take to close the deal, and then 18 months, they left themselves a lot of wiggle room. The other thing is, I do think this deal has lower risk than ARM and NVIDIA, in that, you know, I saw a lot of the value in that deal. And let's not forget, NVIDIA's stock price went up enough on that day they announced to pay for that entire acquisition. I think AMD is down now, which makes this a little bit different. And by the way, and that's not to say that I think NVIDIA ARM is risky. I think they're both good deals. But if I look at what it takes, I mean, essentially, we're talking about PCIe cards and FPGAs that are soldered onto motherboards here.
I know we wanted to keep this short, so we'll just say the challenge to getting the deal to close for this AMD Xilinx deal feels much more achievable with less hurdles. We've all seen what global deals. We saw Qualcomm NXP. That one ended up not going through. The ARM NVIDIA deal, I do think Jensen has good experience on the global acquisition front, good relations with the, you know, the FTCs across Asia. But there is a bigger challenge. There's going to be probably more contesting of that deal than this deal. And so that is certainly part of it, Pat. And I think you make a great point about the value. The stock is down, was down, but based on its earnings, this deal going through. And by the way, Xilinx stock exploded today. So on the other side, you know, sometimes you never really know what investors are thinking. I will say the last thing, Pat, to make this deal work and those numbers you shared work is just Xilinx, the company needs to get back on growth trajectory. AMD's growth trajectory is tremendous, but that was one thing I did note when I was tracking this deal was Xilinx growth has been a little bit stagnant to down. And yeah. I haven't heard that yet out loud from any of the pundits, but that I think goes back to a little bit of what I said about the FPGA to ASIC conversion that's been going on is I still think there might be another move. There might be another move. So anyway, good stuff.
Hey, by the way, AMD, as Simon Schultes says, AMD is actually up in after hours. It was down. It was down 5% pre-market, and it's still pre-market, but it looks like it's almost up 1%.
Oh, that's great. I mean, I wouldn't, we, that's what happens when you sit here and you're on this instead of on that. But yeah, I woke up, the first thing I did, Pat, no joke, is I looked at the stock and I saw it was actually pre-market about an hour ago, it was down like $3. I'm like, how is that possible? It just announced earnings and it's announced this acquisition. But then I looked at Xilinx and it was up like $14. I'm like, I guess all the energy is going that way right now. But yeah, very, very good. And appreciate the chance to discuss this.
And Celia, thank you for the kind comment. Celia and I worked together, gosh, almost 25 years ago at Compaq. But again, this is a fun platform. This is the first time we're broadcasting live on LinkedIn. We hope you like it. If you like what you're hearing, go to YouTube on Daniel and R's YouTube sites and press subscribe, where we have a weekly show. And we also have an insider show where we interview technology industry's most influential technology executives. For that, let's go to grab another cup of coffee, Daniel, and we're signing out. Thanks, everybody.